This is the story of Atlantis. You can read along with me in your book. You'll know it's time to turn the page when you hear this sound. And now, let's journey to a place known only in legends. Thousands of years ago, the thriving city of Atlantis found itself gripped in unspeakable terror. On this fateful day, the Atlantean citizens ran in panic as a monstrous tidal wave raced across the ocean directly toward them, threatening to wipe them out. Amid the confusion, the Atlantean warriors darted about on their armada of flying stonefish vehicles, shouting in their native tongue in a vain attempt to restore order. Running for cover with the king and queen of Atlantis, young Princess Kida dropped her favorite doll. Suddenly, a strange beam of light from the sky closed in on them. In horror, Kida saw the beam begin to lift her mother away. Helplessly losing her grip on her daughter, the queen removed a bracelet from Kida's small wrist. Astonished, the king cautioned Kida to close her eyes. He looked up as the queen was absorbed into a giant crystal hovering in the sky above the city. The king sadly offered thanks and a silent goodbye to his beloved wife. Suddenly, the crystal sent out a great blue dome of pure energy that covered the entire city. The dome held fast as the huge tidal wave washed over Atlantis, sinking it to the center of the earth. Within seconds, there was almost no trace of its existence. Ages passed. By the year 1914, Atlantis was a myth to practically everyone except Milo Thatch, an expert in maps and languages. At the museum where he worked, he tried to convince the directors that Atlantis was real.
10,000 years before the Egyptians built the pyramids, Atlantis had electricity, advanced medicine, even the power of flight. Numerous ancient cultures all over the globe agree that Atlantis possessed a power source of some kind, more powerful than our modern internal combustion engines. Gentlemen, I propose that we find Atlantis, find that power source, and bring it back to the surface.
Unfortunately, the museum directors flatly rejected Milo's proposal as ridiculous folklore. There were others, however, who believed in Atlantis.
Milo James Thatch.
Who are you? How did you get in here?
I came down the chimney. Ho, ho, ho. My name is Helga Sinclair. I'm acting on behalf of my employer, who has a most intriguing proposition for you. Are you interested?
Helga brought Milo to the cavernous mansion of wealthy eccentric Preston Whitmore. In the gallery, Milo noticed a familiar portrait.
Grandpa?
Then he noticed an old man sitting like a pretzel on the floor.
Preston Whitmore. Join me in a little yoga?
Did you really know my grandfather?
We stayed close friends till the end of his days. Push on that table. It's for you.
It's the Shepherd's Journal. Mr. Whitmore, this journal is the key to finding the lost continent of Atlantis.
Whitmore used his vast resources of engineers and geologists to organize an expedition. Soon, Milo found himself being welcomed aboard an enormous submarine by Commander Rohr.
Pleasure to meet the grandson of old Thaddeus.
But the introductions were cut short by Communications Officer Packard.
Commander, I'm picking up something on the hydrophone I think you should hear.
A strange sound filled the submarine.
Helmsman, bring us about. Tighten our search pattern and slow us down.
A crushing blow pounded the sound. The crew tumbled about the deck. Outside, the Leviathan, a gigantic sea monster who guarded the entrance to Atlantis, was clawing at the ship.
Fire torpedoes!
Milo stared out the porthole.
Jiminy Christmas! It's a machine!
Their torpedoes were no match for the massive Leviathan. The doomed sub took a terrible beating. Audrey, the tough engineer, was in a panic.
Run! We took a big hit down here! We're making our way back! I don't want to be around when it hits the boiler!
You heard the lady. Let's move!
All hands abandon ship! All hands abandon ship!
The crew escaped in their aqua evac vehicles as the sub was crushed to scrap metal. The fierce Leviathan immediately bombarded the smaller vehicles. Rourke spotted a crevice in the rocks.
There, up ahead.
The Leviathan, unable to follow, shot a furious electrical beam that sent the last few subpods into collision with each other. Milo, Commander Rourke, and the other survivors gathered in a huge underground cave.
7 hours ago, we started this expedition with 200 of the finest men and women I've ever known. We're all that's left.
After following the Atlantean highway for some time, Milo came to a large, beautifully carved pillar.
It's got to be half a mile high, at least. It must have taken thousands of years to carve this thing.
Explosives expert Vinny casually pushed Milo out of the way and ringed the pillar with dynamite.
Hey, look, I made a bridge. It only took me 10 seconds, 11 tops.
The group crossed the fallen pillar and continued exploring. Finally, they came upon a glowing rock formation in the ceiling. Milo knew they were close.
This is it. It's gotta be.
As the crew ate their dinner, Milo kept studying the Shepherd's Journal.
This doesn't make any sense. See, in this passage here, the Shepherd seems to be leading up to something. He calls it the Heart of Atlantis. It could be the power source the legends refer to, but then it just cuts off. It's almost like there's a missing page.
Later, as everyone slept, three mysterious figures crept into camp, but scurried away as Milo emerged from his tent. Without thinking, Milo shined his flashlight on the glowing rock formation, and what looked like fireflies swarmed out of them. To his horror, the bugs set the camp ablaze. The crew tried to escape, but a fuel truck caught fire and exploded, destroying the bridge and sending the trucks plummeting into a dark chasm. Molière, known as Mole, put his ear to the ground.
We are standing at the base of a dormant volcano. The magma has solidified in the bowels of the volcano, effectively blocking the exit.
If we could blow the top off of that thing, we'd have a straight shot to the surface. Mr. Thatch, what do you think? Mr. Thatch?
Thatch?
Milo was lying some distance away, injured and unconscious. He awoke to find three visitors staring intently at him. In Atlantean, they discussed who he might be and whether he should live. The trio's leader, a young woman, placed a blue crystal on Milo's wound, and it healed instantly. But the sound of roaring engines approaching caused the three to run away.
Hey, wait a minute! Who are you? Come back!
Just then, Audrey and the crew plowed a digger truck through a wall behind Milo. Revealing the spectacular world of Atlantis.
It's beautiful.
An army of Atlantean warriors surrounded the team, speaking in a variety of languages, including English. Rourke stepped forward.
We are explorers from the surface world. We come in peace.
The young woman turned out to be Princess Kida, and she escorted the crew to her father, the king. He was not pleased, but he agreed to let the explorers stay one night. That evening, Kida took Milo to see the city. As they reached the top of a huge stone statue, Milo was overwhelmed by the view.
Wow. You know, my grandpa used to tell me stories about this place as far back as I can remember. Just wish he could be standing here with me.
Later, he and Kida swam to an underwater mural that showed the Atlanteans wearing crystals around their necks. Things were starting to make sense to Milo.
It's the heart of Atlantis. That's what the shepherd was talking about. It was some kind of crystal, like these. Like, you'd think something as important would have been in the journal, but... unless... the missing page.
When Milo and Kida reached the water's edge, Rourke and crew were waiting with guns and the missing page.
Such an idiot. This is just another treasure hunt for you. You're after the crystal. You don't know what you're tampering with, Rourke.
What's to know? It's gonna make us all rich.
Rourke confronted the king.
How about it, Chief? Where's the crystal chamber?
This outrage was too much for Joshua Sweet, the crew's doctor.
Rourke, this was not a part of the plan.
Rourke was about to pull the trigger when he noticed a light beaming on a reflecting pool. In the pool lay a group of rocks that matched the Atlantean A on the journal.
This is it. We're in.
Rourke stepped onto the rocks, and Milo, Helga, and Kida followed. The rocks then descended like an elevator down to the Atlantean Crystal Chamber of Kings. Inside the chamber, the mother crystal floated high above a pool of water as huge stones, each carved with the face of a king, slowly orbited it. The mother crystal sent beams through the chamber, unnerving the normally icy Helga.
Come on, let's get this over with. I don't like this place.
Kida fell into a trance and entered the reflecting pool. As Milo, Helga, and Rourke watched, Kida was lifted to the mother crystal, while the king stone's faces spun around her. Then, Kida became the crystal herself, and she slowly returned to the water. Milo felt like he'd lost a friend.
Kida.
Later, at the Atlantean arena, the crew half-heartedly followed Rourke's orders and loaded the crystalline Kida onto the transport. Audrey and the crew decided to side with Milo.
This is wrong and you know it.
If that's the way you want it, fine. More for me.
Rourke climbed into his truck. Meanwhile, in the palace, Milo sat at the dying king's side as he explained Kida's transformation.
In times of danger, the crystal would choose a host, one of royal blood, to protect itself and its people. The crystal thrives on the collective emotions of all who came before us. In return, it provides power, longevity, protection. In my arrogance, I sought to use it as a weapon of war, but its power proved too great to control.
That's why you hid it beneath the city, to keep history from repeating itself.
And to prevent Kida from suffering the same fate as my beloved wife. If she remains bonded to the crystal, she could be lost to it forever. The love of my daughter is all I have left. Return the crystal. Save Atlantis. Save my daughter.
Milo stormed from the throne room.
I'm going after Rourke.
To the amazement of the crew, he boarded a stonefish and started it.
Just follow my lead. Now let's do it!
They found Rourke and Helga at the volcano shaft, sending the crystal Kida aloft in a balloon. A dramatic dogfight ensued as Rourke's troopers fired at the stonefish, and Milo and crew retaliated with spears and crystal laser beams. Then, Milo leapt aboard the balloon, carrying it with his stonefish, and Audrey and Sweet started sawing the chains that attached Kida's pod to the balloon. Noting the altitude loss, Rourke lightened the load by tossing Helga overboard.
Ladies first. Nothing personal!
On the ground, the mortally wounded Helga shot a flare at the balloon, setting it aflame.
Nothing personal.
Milo and Rourke battled in the air, jumping from chain to chain. Grabbing an axe, Rourke swung at Milo, shattering Kida's crystal pod. Milo grabbed a glowing crystal shard and cut Rourke. The evil man glowed blue, then fiery red. Hardening to a solid crystal, the hideous beast pursued Milo until the balloon's swing blades put him to an end.
Thank heaven.
Milo pushed the pod, holding his beloved Kida away before the balloon exploded. But Mole's attention was at his feet.
The volcano! She awakes!
Lava spewed up from fissures, tearing through the ground.
We gotta get her back or the whole city will die!
Milo led the crew to the plaza, where he released the still crystallized Kida. But Atlantis was still in danger. Sweet sounded the alarm.
Milo, Mole says the wall's gonna blow!
Suddenly, Kida floated up above the plaza, and the king stones began spinning. The stone giants rose from the ground. They clapped their hands, and a dome of energy saved the city once again. The mother crystal released the living Kida, and she floated down to Milo's arms. In her hand was the bracelet her mother had taken. Atlantis was restored. Weeks later, Audrey, Mole, Sweet, Packard, Vinny, and Cookie paid a visit to Mr. Whitmore. Together, they concocted a story in order to protect the secrets of Atlantis. Milo stayed behind with Kida. With the Mother Crystal returned to its rightful place in the sky, the city was more beautiful than ever. And for Milo, Atlantis was an empire found.